Metro Manila is now considered to be in the safe zone as it falls below 60%. Is that reflective of what's happening on the ground? Joining us now is Dr. Jonas Del Rosario, the spokesman of the Philippine General Hospital. Good morning, Dr. Jonas. Thank you for joining us again.
Good morning, Nikki, and to your televiewers.
Okay, so first off, as we reported, we have the DOH reporting ICU utilization rates in NCR dropping to 59%, isolation beds at 38%, ward beds at 43%. Is PGH actually experiencing this downtrend as well in their ICU bed rates as well as total bed utilization?
For the ICU, unfortunately, since our patients are quite sick, our ICUs remain to be full. We're 100% occupied. And most of the time, the moment there's an opening, a new patient has to be moved into the ICU. So in terms of ICU utilization in PGH, we're still at 100%. But the ICU, the utilization rate for the whole COVID hospital now is down to 60%, which is pretty much in agreement to what's being seen in other hospitals. We do not have a long line anymore in our emergency rooms, and even if they go through our ERs, they are readily accepted in a matter of 1 to 2 days into our wards. So right now we have close to 170 patients confirmed COVID admitted to PGH out of our 300 beds. So that's roughly about 60%. That's a big improvement from we used to be taking care of patients about 300. At one time, we have about 350 patients. So we're steadily seeing the decline of COVID admissions.
All right, that's really good to know. Now, concerning the downtrend in our COVID numbers, you know, the deaths, recoveries, active cases, how accurately do you think data reported by the DOH actually reflects the situation on the ground?
It seems like even though there are issues that sometimes there are some of the labs are not able to send their results, and sometimes maybe they're not able to capture some of the hospital admissions. But I think pretty much I agree with what the numbers that they are showing. It seems to be reflective even in PGH. So I think they're pretty accurate, and they have access to all of these hospitals anyway. Just like what was mentioned by USEC Vergara, that they actually have the data of all the hospitals, whether it's a primary hospital or even in a referral center.
Let's go to the pediatric vaccinations. Now, how have you been monitoring the first 12 kids who have since been vaccinated in PGH? And we know this week you're looking to inoculate about 350 minors. What's the system in place for PGH pediatric vaccinations?
Well, we were a little bit slower than the other pilot hospitals. Initially, on our first day, we just inoculated. Actually, we planned to inoculate 12, but only 9 showed up. But that's fine because we really just wanted to see our system, and seems just sort of like a dry run. Most of our kids in PGH have significant comorbidity. So we're sort of like extra careful to monitor them. We have the what we call the AEFI surveillance team, the adverse events following immunization, that's in place. What we have done is, since in PGH, we have a lot of subspecialties from cardiology, nephrology, pulmonology, etc. We have assigned this subspecialty divisions to monitor their own patients in a way, because they know them by heart. So every day, the way that we did it in PGH, we classify the patients who come in for immunization. So if, let's say for Monday, it's going to be patients with lung problems and kidney diseases. So the specialists involved in this care are there in PGH. So that it's also nice for these kids to identify their doctors being there. There's an element of being, they feel safe that the ones who really know them are there to monitor them. And then we actually have a system wherein even after the immunization and even after a few days, we have a system of we will monitor these patients up to about a year just to see the effects of the vaccine.
And going back to our COVID numbers, even our current positivity rate has actually dropped to 13.3%. Can you tell us what you think is happening here as a medical doctor? Can we say that we are getting more resistant to contracting the virus, or is the Delta strain also becoming less of a threat?
I think the threat is still there. The Delta virus is predominantly mm-hmm. what we have right now. I think a lot of our kababayans have been inoculated, have been vaccinated, and then there are probably a lot of people who already contracted the disease, and so in some ways are also protected. So herd immunity is probably setting in. I mean, I don't think we have the numbers yet, but at least there are more people who either got immunized or got infected, so there's some form of immunity. The second thing is, I think people in some ways really follow the health protocols, and maybe at some level the way that the change in the in terms of levels, level 4 or level 3 probably help also. So it's a combination of the patient or the community getting some type of immunity and also the system in place.
Mm-hmm. And what about PGH's supply of COVID treatment equipment as well as supply of medicines? Has demand also for them eased?
Well, now that we're taking care of less patients, so the demand for high flow oxygen machines, for example, or oxygen ventilators have decreased. So now we're able to manage more and supply them better. We pretty much have all the medicines except for this tocilizumab, which up to now we're still waiting to be available in the country. But other than that, we're okay. In terms of manpower, again, since we're taking care of less patients, we're now able to cope. Right. Although we have been calling for volunteers for doctors to come into PGH and help us in taking care of COVID patients so that other doctors can be freed up to take care of non-COVID patients.
Mm-hmm. And how many more of your health workers who are fully vaccinated have gotten sick? We know the DOH is also looking into getting booster shots, right? How important do you think it would be to actually have a rollout of booster shots, at least for the...
Well, 95% of our frontliners have been vaccinated either by Sinovac, AstraZeneca, a few had Pfizer and Moderna in some places. We had our share of breakthrough infection. Most of them are mild, some of them had moderate. But we were looking at the, we have a study in PGH, we're monitoring the antibody levels of those who were vaccinated, including those who had their infection. So there is some trend there that after about 6 months, the levels are going down. Although I have to say that there's really no clear correlation between antibody levels and the degree of immunity that somebody has. So, but be that as it may, since it's also being recommended by WHO that boosters can be given to the immunocompromised and the elderly, and maybe even those the healthcare workers or frontliners who are always at risk because of, then we welcome the time when booster can be allowed to our frontliners.
Mm-hmm. And are your frontliners being properly compensated? We know your health workers have been protesting the 1.2 billion 2022 budget cut for PGH, right? What would this mean for your operations, maintenance, utilities, and most importantly, your healthcare services?
Compensation is very important, and we try to give them what they deserve. And usually, the only thing though is the source of the money will be coming from the government. So. As far as I know, whatever was supposed to be given to our frontliners, initially there was some difficulty in trying to classify in terms of who will get what because of strict requirements that only those who are working for COVID facilities or directly taking care of COVID patients should be given the compensation. But I think that has been fixed already, so most of our workers are getting them. With regards to the budget cut, I'm hoping that the director was able to represent PGH. He said he went to the congressional hearing to get some more funding for our hospital.
Mm-hmm. And lastly, what are your thoughts on the IATF lowering NCR to alert level 3? What should the public ultimately keep in mind?
I think it's always difficult to balance trying to keep everybody at home and then also trying to provide food for everyone. So now that we are down to level 3, I think it's really everybody's responsibility to just follow the protocols. I think it's pretty much everybody, I mean, because of the numbers that are going down, I hope that people will not relax. We don't want to go back to another surge. We already know how hard it is for everyone. So let's just follow the protocols, wear a mask, physical distancing. And if it's not necessary for you to go to a public or crowded place, please just don't do that.
Mm-hmm. On that note, thank you so much for always answering our call. Dr. Jonas, please stay safe.
Take care, everyone.